using that feature. If you don't know if people are using it, that's again, it's waste. And this exists. This is all across the business model again, though. This is marketing activities. This is sales methods. It's, you know, any of the back end stuff that's appropriate. And it's sort of the engine that can help you discover how to innovate other places in your business, in your business model. So I've got a little clip here that's kind of fun. Some of you have already seen it, but it's very popular. I've seen it now like 4 million times. But it's a great example. I wonder if this will work.
Along with the Coachella Valley Museum.
Why you don't talk to your customers and ask them to?
This concert goes over 2 weekends. Some of the California desert. More than 60 bands played Coachella this year. Some of the big bands, some of them not so big, some of them up and coming bands. And music fans in general love knowing about bands that no one else has ever heard of. So we decided to conduct an experiment. We sent a camera crew to Coachella. We asked people walking into the venue what they thought of a bunch of bands whose names we made up, okay? These bands are so obscure that they do not exist. Except for one name you'll hear, we made all of them up, but that didn't stop people from saying they knew them. It's tonight's special Coachella edition of Lie Witness News.
One of my favorite bands this year is Dr. Shulman and the GI Clinic.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Yeah, they're always amazing.
Yeah, he's really good on the flex tape.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see them live. I think that's going to be one of the bands that's going to be a really great live
highlight.
Did you see them when they played at Lollapalooza?
No.
No, I didn't.
I'm so mad.
I'm so mad.
Have you heard of Shorty Jizzle and the Plunder Press?
Yeah.
What do you think about them? Like how raw they are?
Yeah, they're really unique, for sure.
They feel a little bit like a combination between like Bob Dylan and like a polka band.
Yeah.
Are you guys as excited as I am about the obesity epidemic?
I just like their whole style, like their whole genre. It was great. They're kind of like very innovative and they're new.
There's some smaller bands that are playing,
yeah.
Two Door Cinema Club.
Yeah, I'm looking forward
they're
to that.
They're good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you like their album DJ Cornmeal?
Yeah, actually, I had a radio show on a community radio station up in Canada and I used to listen to them all the time.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah.
One of my favorite bands this year is called Get the F Out of My Pool.
Yeah. Actually, I've heard from my friends, I don't know any of the music, but I heard from my friends that it's not something this, so I'm not nervous.
One of my favorite things today, straight out of Williamsburg, the Chelsea Clintons.
Oh, yeah, I have heard of them, actually. No, yeah, I don't know if I'm going to see them or not, but I do know of their music.
What did you hear about them?
They're just fun.
What's fun about the Chelsea Clintons?
I think they just give off that energy.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you can just tell that they're doing it from a good place, and it's like, and you can just feel energy. Like, there's very few acts that like give you that feeling.
Did you know that Coachella is actually the American Indian word for dumb white guy?
Alright. So you can't just go ask for cut. There's all sorts of reasons why customers will think they're trying to please you, right? They're trying to answer for you. If you just go and it's interesting to me, if you ask customers, like if you go to say to somebody, say, yeah, I got this great startup idea, and then you tell it to them and you say, what do you think? You're actually asking them to help you. You've completely taken them out of the context of whether they have a problem that you should be solving, and you've asked them to solve your problem. And then they get into that mode, right? And they'll give you a laundry list of features because they're just sitting there brainstorming with you. Oh yeah, maybe you can build XYZ. And it's like, why believe that crap, right? I mean, this happens to enterprises all the time, right? This is how they develop products. The IT department goes to the business unit and they go, yeah, well, what do you want in the app? And they're just inviting people to create this huge laundry list of features that nobody knows anybody will ever use. Like, what's the stat in Microsoft Word? It's like 90% of the people use 10% of the features or something like that. I mean, you get this bloated software because, yeah, it's all just like, what are we gonna build this year? Okay, let's go to the database of features that have been requested. I mean, it's crazy. Understand why they're asking what they're asking for. So, when we talk about market segments, you don't want to think about demographics. You don't want to think about firmographics, which is, you know, like company size or verticals. When you're first innovating, when you're first trying to create value, you actually want to go to a narrow market segment. It doesn't mean you're going to stick with it, but it's where you're going to find your early adopters, and that's going to you're going to figure out how you're going to create value for them. You can't just go out and create value for a million people. It just doesn't work that way. All big businesses started small, by definition. They grew big as they figured stuff out. So I like to think about market segments as being a group of people that share the same pain or passion and speak the same language. And by speak the same language, I mean that they'll refer to each other for products and solutions having to do with that pain or passion. So if you're building a square hat, you want to sell to blockheads, not cylinder heads, and not just all people that are between 20 and 40. There was a company in San Francisco that called Beta Brands. They're still around. One of their first products was bike to work pants. So the pants had little cuffs that you could fold up that were reflective, and a little flag you could pull out of your back pocket that was reflective, so it's safer to ride your bike to work. Get to work, you fold down the cuffs, put the flag back in, and you're ready to go. It has nothing to do with age and income. It's people who bike to work. And there's already a community of people that bike to work. And so if you can think about your idea, and it doesn't apply to all ideas, but does a community already exist that you can sell into, or is there one that you can create around your product? Because that naturally attracts people that share the same pain or passion. And you figure out for the early adopters there, then you've likely discovered this larger market segment. So again, you're starting from unknown, you work through this market segment, you figure out how to sell to it, now you can bring that to your execution engine, and now as the founders, you should still go out into the search mode. What's my next hurdle that I need to overcome? How do I sell to the next market segment? Or what's another product I can sell to the existing one? And that's how you grow. So in my company, I'm kind of the guy that's out on the search side, and my co-founder is a big operations guy, and so he manages the execution side. I learn, my team learns, we put it over into the execution side, and they should be able to start scaling it up. So the way we do this, I'm sure you guys are all familiar with personas. So this is our Zoom tool that we're going to try out a little bit later, if you'd like. Basically a way to describe the attributes and behaviors of real people. So there's a lot of groups out there that do personas around, that sort of create caricatures. And some of the huge design thinking firms will help these companies create caricatures. The people actually don't really exist. And you have a hard time creating new products for them. You can market to them. They give you enough information that it's good for marketing, maybe, when you're like huge, but not when you're innovating. And so we want to think about what real people, what are different market segments for people that exist out there. So I was helping a team do at a hackathon, and they wanted to build a fashion app. And so I went on and on. We did this whole workshop for them. Went on for about an hour. And afterwards, you know, they're supposed to be filling out their Zoom tool. Brant, we're having problems. Okay, who's your market segment, do you think? And they say, all people who shop for clothes in brick and mortar stores. And I'm all like, holy crap, that's not a market segment. That's everybody in the world. What problem do they have? Oh, they can't find clothes they like. What's your solution? Our app. And it's like, you guys are a waste of time. So I go through a series of questions, though. Is it all people that shop in brick and mortar stores? Is it both men and women? No, it's the women. Is it the women that shop in the boutique on Santa Monica Boulevard in FLA, and the women that are shopping in that discount store, Ross Dress for Less? Oh, no, it's the women that go to the boutique. Is it the younger woman that's looking for a cocktail dress? She's out with her friends? Or is it the older woman who still wants to look great? Oh, no, it's the younger woman. Yeah, no, it's the younger woman. She's going to go, like, she needs a cocktail dress. Describe it to a point that you can go find that person. And they did. They went to the boutiques, and it turns out they don't have a problem. I just had a glass of wine. I got plenty of clothes. We're having fun. Didn't have a problem. By the end of the weekend, their market segment were young hipster guys that hated shopping, that couldn't find clothes that look good and fit. So you again, you want to narrow it down. There's an entrepreneur that I'm helping in Madison. I don't know why all my stories are fashion stories, but I mean, clearly I don't use them. But it's the he was building an app where you would choose one article of clothing and hit a shuffle button, and it would complete your wardrobe. And so I was just doing some mentoring sessions for startups there, and I said, well, what do you need? How can I help you? What's your biggest need? I need 1,000 customers. How many do you have? Zero. You don't need 1,000, you need one. You can't build value for 1,000 if you can't create value for one. I said, go out onto the streets. They were teeming with people. Find one person willing to click the shuffle button. It's a great experiment. So, again, to beat a dead horse, you start small in order to go big. So this is the problem zoom, so this is a way for us to learn what are the desired outcomes, so what is their aspiration, not only what is the problem you're trying to solve, but what is their bigger aspiration. This matters to consumers and to businesses, by the way. So when I was selling into IT, one of the startups I worked at had a real hard time because we required them to forklift their servers out. Even though we're way better technology, way less expensive, asking an IT guy to take servers offline and put new stuff in was a huge ask. Person's job is on the line. The existing stuff, it's working all right. I'm not gonna unplug it. I know you're better, but I've already got budget for this, so you have to understand those things and you can hypothesize all of that. And then there's the solution zoom, which the goal is to get you to an MVP, to get you to the minimum viable product. And the minimum viable product is not the minimum product, right? It's not crappy product. It has to be viable. Viable means that the customer is receiving value from it such that they would be pay for it or whatever, sign up, or whatever your conversion is. There was I was presenting this stuff in Chicago one time, and this guy's like, this lean startup stuff is crap, it doesn't work, this MVP, that's bullshit. I said, all right, settle down, what's going on? He's like, I built this really crappy website for weddings, you know, I was trying to build a marketplace for brides shopping for wedding stuff, and in the market, you know, bringing the photographers and the caterers together and all that. I'm like, wait a second, you said you built a really crappy website? He's like, it looked horrible. I go, women that are like planning their wedding are not going to go to a horrible looking website to buy stuff for their wedding. That doesn't make any sense. It was minimal, but it wasn't anywhere close to viable. So you have to understand your market segment. Maybe it has to look great. Maybe it has to have a super polished user experience. I mean, but the key is that you don't want to overbuild, right? Because then you don't understand where inside your product your value proposition really lies. And so it's good to underbuild just a little bit and then iterate until like your early adopters are going, holy crap, I want this now. And this is actually happens in enterprises. So enterprises building massive hardware, GE building CAT scanners. And they saw a reduction in their go to market by 50% because they're already doing physical prototypes. So hardware prototypes have been done for ages, but in the past it was mostly to reduce technical risk. Well, take that prototype and bring it to the customers. And they would iterate on it to the point where the customers are like, you're gonna leave this here, right? Oh no, we gotta bring it back and finish out that specification that we wrote that's gonna take another 3 years. And the customer's like, no, it works. I wanna just leave it. It's their minimum viable product. So the whole concept of the experiments is that you're continuing to iterate until you get to that point where you know what viable is. You know that your customer's problem is being solved. So all of these Zooms, by the way, are describing this persona of Freddie Castle. And Freddie Castle is a person who travels for work, lives in an urban environment, and when he travels, he wants a local's experience. So he doesn't want to just stay in a hotel, eat in the hotel restaurant. He wants to feel like a local wherever he goes. I'm sort of that way. And interesting enough, I don't know if you know this, but that was Airbnb's market segment. So their messaging said it really sort of from the beginning, though they iterated several times. But even their current messaging, belong anywhere. The whole idea is that you can travel anywhere in the world and feel like you're a local. That's who they're appealing to. And so basically your messaging at that point, if you're Airbnb, is what's the utility? The utility is I'm going to give you a place to stay, and it's going to be a good deal. It's going to be less expensive, likely, than a hotel, and you're going to get connected to a local's experience. And so you're going to have great experiences when you travel. That's sort of this aspirational element to it. And it's fascinating. I've got it. I don't think I have it in this presentation. Maybe I do. But it's fascinating. You have a different... you could see the... If you go to the Wayback Machine, the Internet Archive, and you can see the progression of landing pages from startups, and you can see the progression of their messaging and their logos and all this kind of stuff. So kind of going back to the branding element stuff. Successful startups had crappy branding. They don't spend any money on branding. Nobody cares about branding elements anymore. So if you get pressure from your investors to get a better logo or a better domain name, it's like, it's crap. You can go do that after you find product market fit, after you're starting to scale. Airbnb waited forever. Their first logo looked, you know, like one that lost in a 99 Designs contest. It's really bad. And just recently, the one that they just recently launched, which is this logo up there, super expensive. And I don't think I have this slide here, but that the symbol breaks apart into like these values that they have, and you can just tell they spend a ton of money on it. And in the U.S., when we have our American football championship, the Super Bowl, that's when everybody spends all their money on advertising. And there's an Airbnb commercial on it, and the only thing they showed, the only thing they did identify themselves that this was their commercial, was the logo. Nobody understood who it was. It's not necessarily a bad thing, it's just kind of an interesting thing to me. And there's some books that are coming out now. People are starting to talk about like all of this logo stuff in today's day. It just doesn't matter. But it's funny, because it's something that startups will spend a lot of money on. There was a kid that ran out of UCSD that won a contest, and he got like $20,000 and an hour's worth of mentoring from me. I don't know that I was able to help him, but it's like, what are you gonna spend the $20,000 on? Oh, I don't know, you know, some pens with my logo on it, get a new logo, you know, letterhead. I'm like, what is this, like 1984? It's crazy. But anyway, so I've come up with this, what I call the value stream discovery, and this is a way for you to hypothesize and create assumptions for your whole, essentially for your whole business model. So 7 steps that a customer goes through from becoming aware to becoming passionate. And basically, the idea is that in a startup, you don't know until things are proven in the marketplace. And so for each state, you can hypothesize, create an assumption. What's the behavior that our customer has to exhibit that indicates they're at one of the states? And then what do I have to do as a business to get the customer to behave in that way? And how do I measure it? And so I sort of went through it and said, well, if I was Airbnb, what would this look like? Wow, I'm getting ahead of myself here with my, now the clicker's working, where I've got way too much animation. So aware. So you maybe have read the stories on Airbnb's growth hack, where basically they essentially hacked Craigslist. So anytime a listing was created on Airbnb, it automatically created a Craigslist ad, and that just like blew up their traffic. And it's genius, because what they're doing is they're concentrating on what's the customer behavior. Their customers were searching for vacation rentals or places that they could rent in cities on Craigslist. So they were capturing their customer right when they were feeling their pain, right when they were right in the moment of trying to solve their pain. And that's sort of a definition of a growth hack, right? If you can reach your customer with your value prop in the moment that they're trying to solve that problem, that's just genius. And that's kind of the original definition of a growth hack. Now growth hack seems to mean just marketing. But SEO is essentially the same thing. Back in the early 2000s, people get on Google and they do a search. It's right in the middle. They're trying to find something. And so whoever won that search engine war or the optimization, if you're the one that came up in the top two or three, you win, right? So that was a, sort of an original growth hack. But basically, they hypothesized, I can get to my customer right when they're feeling pain by doing this Craigslist hack. The behavior that they expect to see is that they'll click on it and they'll end up on our site instead of a normal Craigslist ad. And then they're going to measure it based upon people landing on Airbnb from Craigslist. So then intrigued is really the messaging that exists on a website or whatever people are going to go to. And to me, the messaging is comprised of two components. It's the utility promise, you have to solve this problem, plus this more aspirational element. So in Airbnb's case, it's inexpensive rooms plus have a locals experience, have a great travel experience. So then you might hypothesis, I just made this up, but you might hypothesis that if you land on Craigslist, you see the ad, you see the messaging, you're like, okay, well, who is this, what is this site? I'm interested, what would I go do next? You know, maybe you'd go look at the About Us page, or you'd go look at a Frequently Asked Questions page, try and learn more about the company. But that behavior indicates that they're actually interested, right? So they're intrigued. So again, what I'm going to measure the funnel on my website based upon how they came in, based upon the source. So here's an example of one version of their messaging. So your home everywhere. Again, locals experience. So then trusting is you have to, the customer has to believe that you're the right company to fulfill this promise. Maybe if I were Airbnb, it would be, again, this frequently asked questions. How do I get them to trust? Usually it's, on their site, they had a bunch of testimonials, and they had articles from major publications, Forbes, and TV snippets from CNN. So that's going to build legitimacy. So what would a customer do if they trust? Well, maybe they'll actually click on the, all right, I want this room. So then these are the things I'm going to measure that indicate that you've got them to trust you. After that, hopefully you get them convinced. How you get them convinced, how you measure that's pretty easily. They reserve the room, right? So maybe it's the Airbnb, it's that they provide the insurance and they convince you that it's safe actually to get a room from a complete stranger. So after you're convinced, you go through this funky state I call hopeful. Hopeful is this gap that exists between buying and trying. And you need that gap as short as possible. So if you've ever downloaded a mobile app and you don't know what to do next, right, you've lost that customer forever. So the good apps use some sort of a mini tutorial to point you out what you should do right away. Or you sign up for an online site and then you don't go to it right away. And then you forget about it. A good company will do a marketing drip campaign to get them in real specific calls to action. What I found interesting when I was analyzing Airbnb is their hopeful state is you've booked a room, you hope you've made the right decision, you're a little bit nervous because you've just booked a room from a stranger, you don't know if the photos are valid, you don't know if it's a real listing, you're just like, holy crap. And what and the same thing actually on the renter side, like, you know, did I just like rent to a psycho? So there's this kind of this period of unease. And what Airbnb does really well is tries a bunch of different channels to get those two to communicate as quickly as possible. They'll try to get you to do a phone call or even a text message. They'll start firing off all of these things to try to connect you as quickly as possible so you get over that hump of being of doubt. The other fun example I like to use is, you know, you buy a big electronic car for a kid for the holidays or whatever. Kid unwraps a present, they're all like, oh yeah, this is so cool. Take it out, and they're like, oh, holy crap, I forgot to buy the batteries. You run off to the store, buy the batteries, you come back, and the kid's now inside the box going vroom vroom, this is so cool, car's abandoned, you know, in the corner. So this is like why we buy toys with batteries included stamped on the box. Why are batteries included? So you can try it right away. You can receive the value right away. Inside of tech companies, this is often, it's like the leading indicator of who's going to become engaged in your product. So what is that quick feature value that if they use this, they're going to be hooked, or they're going to be engaged in the product? So Facebook discovered, actually by combing through weblogs of all things, Facebook discovered that their most engaged users, or you're more likely to be engaged if you get 10 friends within a week. And that's why, if you remember back when you first joined Facebook, that's all they're doing in the first days, is trying to connect you with as many friends as possible. And they still do it, right? So if you can get to that number 10 within 7 days, you're more likely to be an engaged customer. So what's that hook? What is that leading indicator of a customer that's going to be satisfied, is the way I put it. So satisfied happens when you fulfill that utility promise you made back in Intrigue. You've solved the problem. If you can't solve my problem, I don't care, I'm gone. So this is, again, it's not the classic vanity metrics. It's not how many downloads, it's not how many people are poking around your website, it's not even how many people have signed up, it's not even how many people have logged in. What is the specific functionality that your customer uses over some specified time? If you're e-commerce, it could be repeat transactions. Even if you're offline, there's like a, I was talking to a contact lens manufacturer, and they go, yeah, we sell a contact lens once, but if you keep coming back to buy all of the liquid stuff, we know that you're still using the product, right? So you can look at any of the other products that they have to buy. So there's all sorts of clever ways that you can get to the behavior and measuring that behavior. But you want to put a stake in the ground. This is what a satisfied customer looks like. By putting a stake in the ground, 7 out of 10 will use the product this way. By putting a stake in the ground, it lets you know whether you've gotten there or not. Whether you have the right customer, do you have the right metric, do you have the right product. And you're iterating on the product until you get them to that point that, yeah, that looks like a satisfied customer. And when you sort of get into the advanced mode, you're actually running cohorts. So you can measure, cohorts are groups of users that sign up in different months, right? So you're going to compare month zero to month zero of a second cohort, or month one to month one to month one in across 3 different months. And that allows you to measure, when I make changes to my product, I'm increasing that first month's engagement. I'm getting people to get engaged quicker. And that actually determines the velocity of your company. So if you can reduce by 50% how quickly people get to being engaged, then you've doubled your capacity, essentially, your growth capacity. So the last one in this framework is passionate. And this one is super tricky. Entrepreneurs tend to think that passion is going to come out of the product, and it's not true. Sometimes the user experience is so brilliant, so over the top that you love the product. But more often than not, passion is going to come from something else. It's going to come from your understanding of their aspiration, and so you're going on this journey together to hopefully achieve that aspiration. You can't promise the aspiration. You're both hoping that you're going to get there. You can only promise the utility part. So the entrepreneur I was helping in Toronto, this time it's not a fashion app, it's a music app. He says that if my kid uses the music app, my kid will practice more and become a better musician. So he can promise, he has to promise that my kid will get better, will practice more if they use the app. I asked the guy, why did you build this app? He's all like, oh, I'm trying to save parents money. And I'm all like, what? That doesn't really make sense. I have to pay for the app. I'm paying for the lessons. How are you saving me money? I go, no. Why you? What's driven you to build this? And he says, well, I'm a musician. I go, okay. Why? What about you being a musician? Oh, I want kids to grow up to love music. And I'm like, yeah, me too. That's why I'm paying for the lessons, because I want my daughter to love music. So that's a shared aspiration. We can go on a journey together. You can't promise my kid's gonna love music, but we can go on this journey together. Hopefully she will. So that could be what brings me to passion. There's a company called Method that disrupted the soap industry. How do you disrupt soap? It's just soap. Well, they put it in containers. So housewives were putting the soap on top of the sink instead of underneath the counter. Kind of flipped the market on its head. If you know HubSpot, HubSpot originally got passionate customers because they did great content marketing. So they're teaching small business owners how to be better entrepreneurs. Their platform is for content marketing. Nobody's going to be passionate about it.